डॉक्टर शर्मा।
थैंक यू रवती, थैंक यू फॉर इनवाइटिंग मी फॉर दिस वेबिनार एंड आई एम डिलाइटेड टू गिव टॉक अबाउट आवर ग्रुप्स रिसर्च इन दिस फोरम एंड And also, I'd like to thank Professor Ananta Suresh for providing such an excellent introduction to proteins. He has done an order of magnitude better than what I could have done. Am I audible? Just want to check before I begin.
Yes, yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, thank you. So, let me share the screen. So, is the screen visible now?
Yes, sure.
Okay, thank you. So, I'll talk about how proteins interact with cell membranes, and it's a biophysical study. We couldn't do much of biology here. And what I'll tell you the story of what we have been learning so far in this particular area. So, why do we want to deal with this? So before we proceed to the actual problem, I will talk about an animal cell. For and I assume that the participants are mostly engineers, so I'll give a brief overview of the animal cell. Those who know about this cell and all, it may be a little bit a repetition or boring to you. Please bear with me, we will have more interesting stuff towards the end. Okay, so here is a cartoon of an animal cell which I have taken from National Geographic. So you can see the definition of they have given is an irregularly shaped nucleus contour cell with flexible membrane. So what does that mean? It has a nucleus, which you can see here, that's the nucleus, and it has a flexible membrane that's been shown here, that's the membrane of the cell. And typical size of an animal cell is 10 to 30 micrometers, and you can see this is much smaller than size of an other diameter of our hair, which is about 200 micron. Now, what I want you to look at more detail is it's not just the animal cell as a nucleus and as a membrane, but inside it has a lot more things which look. I mean, if you have an artistic set of mind, you'll see that there are a lot of nice looking objects. Here is one that's called Golgi body. Here is another one that's endoplasmic reticulum, this entire thing, and there's mitochondria. So there's a few important ones, and there are a few which don't really get much attention. There are some small entities. These are just simple sacs. They are liposomes or vesicles, you can call it. So what is the important part here is you have inside the cell, you have a lot more structure. And in all these structures, or most of these structures rather, there is always a membrane associated. Meaning the cell membrane, of course, gives the cell a shape which is flexible, which means depending on the environment, cell can change its shape or adapt to any environment. Other than that, inside the cell also there are a lot of internal compartments, which I may say so, as Golgi body and endoplasmic reticulum and mitochondria, they are all having membranes. And you can see these membranes are not just simple enclosure, right? They have a reasonably complex geometry. Okay, so we will slowly go one by one go and tell why are this necessary and why are they for. So in this here, what I mentioned in the last slide is irregularly shaped. The animal cell is irregularly shaped and it's flexible and it has lots of compartments. We can call these compartments as organelles. They are endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi body, mitochondria, etc., etc. Now, why are they there, or is it necessary for them to be there, or can we do away with them? So to understand that, in this particular schematic, what you see is this sort of cross-sectional view of the Golgi body. and this side, on the right side, we have the plasma membrane and the extracellular space. So what happens is, I mean, several proteins, you were mentioned as soluble proteins, which is soluble meaning they are soluble in the cytosol, that is the liquid or watery environment inside the cell. So they get synthesized in the Golgi body, different types of proteins, and then they get taken away to the plasma membrane and to the outside of the cell. It can be other way also, things can come inside through the membrane as well. So membrane is now here enclosed in the proteins are getting synthesized, they are getting enclosed in the membrane. This particular part may get pinched off, as you can see, this gets pinched off, reaches here and then goes to the outside of the cell, and similarly here. So that's one type of the proteins. And other than that also, we can have proteins that are not soluble, rather they bind to the membrane. And even in those cases, they get synthesized in endoplasmic reticulum or in the Golgi body, or they get go from one particular region to another. And in all these cases, the proteins either get encapsulated by the membrane, or proteins bind on the membrane and the membrane gets pinches off, makes a sac or a vesicle, and then goes to another part of the cell. So in that sense, the function of the animal cell or this membrane, these compartments, are they synthesize and transport proteins and other material within and across cell. And one key constituent other than the protein is the plasma membrane or other membrane of the cell. And I'll tell you in a bit that the Professor Suresh has mentioned that proteins are indeed a smart chitin kind of structure. We can say the same about the membrane when we look at their structure. So I'll tell a little bit more about the animal cell membrane. This is a microelectron micrograph of red blood cell plasma membrane, which you see in this region. And they're primarily made of phospholipid molecules. What are those phospholipid molecules? So in this schematic again, this molecule that you see, which has a head and two tails or two legs, they are phospholipid molecules. And if we enlarge it, it's like it has a head, and this head is hydrophilic, meaning they like water, and the tail is hydrophobic. It is, they're mostly hydrocarbon chains, and they don't like water. So, and as we know, our body environment is a lot of water or aqueous. So how does a molecule like this aggregate and give a plasma membrane? So this is where the smartness of these lipid molecules and the membrane comes into picture. It is like you have a layer, which we can see like this thin sheet, half of it think about. And that sheet, the top part likes water, so it's okay, but the bottom part, hydrocarbon, won't like water. So what it does, like if I have, think about my hand, the palm side is hydrophobic and the other side is hydrophilic. In that case, to isolate the hydrophobic elements, what we do is to put them together. Okay, so this forms a bilayer, and that's how very smartly the hydrophilic part is getting exposed to water, and the hydrophobics are chains or the parts of the molecules are isolated from water if you have a closed membrane, and which is the case in most of the compartments. Okay. So, and apart from the lipid bilayer or the lipid, it has many proteins as well, which you can see the green ones are the proteins. The proteins that are shown here are the ones that go across the membrane thickness, but many a times the proteins can just sit on top of the membrane. Okay. So this means if the membrane has a bilayer structure which isolates hydrophobic tails from water, and more than that, this bilayer is flexible and fluid-like. What do I mean by the term fluid-like? That is, in this cartoon it's a static one, we don't see much, but these lipid molecules as well as these proteins can move around on the membrane quite fast or diffuse around. So that's why they are called fluid-like, or it has an in-plane fluidity. So in that sense, this is again another complex nature comes into picture. The membrane, if you want to deform them or bend them out of the plane, it will resist somewhat. But if you want to shear them or try to in the plane, then they will just move like a fluid. Okay, they won't put up any resistance. And the closest to this also comes, the soap film would be another example of a film which is also liquid-like. Okay, now these lipid molecules in an animal cell membrane, they're not just one type of lipid. There are various different types of lipid. They are distinguished by their hydrophilic head and hydrophobic tail or the hydrocarbon chains. And cholesterol is also one of those lipids which constitute the plasma membrane. And there are some examples, I'm not going into the details, the different membrane of a cell, be it plasma membrane or internal membrane, have different lipid composition. And that is also important for the function of a cell. So key observations thus far are animal cell membrane is made of lipid bilayer, which is flexible and fluid-like, and organelle or the compartments such as endoplasmic reticulum and Golgi, they're extremely curved and complex shape. And the thing is, this complex shape is that we have seen here are preserved across various species. It's not just special to human beings or another animal, it's pretty much all organisms. So all complex organisms which are made out of multiple cells. So, and then in this case, we'll see later the membrane curvature does play an active role in maintaining this structure or the and inhomogeneity, which is also required for the functionality of the cell. The inhomogeneity part I will elaborate a bit more in detail later. So the question is, how do the organelles generate and maintain these complex shapes? So we have the hypothesis that several membrane-bound proteins and sometimes lipids also, the lipids, they look like cylindrical, but sometimes they can be conical, and they deform the membrane to a desired curvature. This part I'm talking as generation, whereas many other proteins which may have an intrinsic curved shape and they would like to bind to regions of compatible curvature. So that part I'm talking them as mentioning as sensing. So together these two will become membrane curvature sensing and generation or sorting of proteins, which I'll talk about. And again, the flexibility and fluid nature of the lipid bilayer is of extreme importance to make this happen, because without the flexibility, proteins cannot deform the membrane, and without the fluid nature, the proteins cannot move to a region of compatible curvature. So both are extremely important for our cells to function. And so what are the different mechanisms how membrane or proteins can sense or generate membrane curvature or deform the membrane? I'll list a few. One is called scaffolding, where the green one is a protein. It's a reasonably large protein. It has its intrinsic shape. You can think of this protein as much stiffer than the bilayer, almost rigid, let's say. And when it binds or comes close to the bilayer, here it's only lipid, this one, it can have much more, many other proteins in it as well, comes to the bilayer, what it will do, it will try to make the bilayer conform to its internal curved shape. How would it do it? One reason the protein would come to the bilayer is perhaps the internal surface of the protein is hydrophobic, and that happens. So whenever there is as I told you, the environment is aqueous, so they will try to look for some surfaces where they can isolate this part from water. There is one possibility is coming close to the lipid bilayer. And another possibility is the lipid membrane can be negatively charged, which is the case many a times, and the proteins may have small domains which are positively charged. So because of the electrostatic interaction, they can come close to each other and then make conform to the vesicles, conform to the lipid bilayer membrane and make the membrane deform. Okay, another possibility is the proteins, all these I'm showing, they're not just a single protein, they're probably part of a domain or the region of a protein. So a part of a region of a protein can be completely hydrophobic. So in that case, it has no choice but to isolate itself when we are in the cellular environment. So what it will do, it will try to insert itself into the bilayer. And once it inserts, it will try to push away some of the lipid molecules. And there are several other constraints in that for the membrane. So that will lead to membrane deforming, bulging out, bulging in. There are a lot of other possibilities. So here, this is how this it can generate curvature also. That's called hydrophobic insertion. And the previous one is scaffolding. And there are two more. There's oligomerization. This one will be a smaller protein, which is similar to scaffolding, but it is not strong enough to generate large curvature. But what it can do is deform the membrane by a small amount, recruit other similar proteins, and they come together and generate a significant enough curvature. And then there are steric effects. There also it can insert, but this insertion is not strong enough to induce a large curvature. But then the head group of this protein or the other part of the protein may have some sort of interaction between the repulsive, attractive, whichever way it is convenient, and that will lead to the generation of curvature. So these are some of the mechanisms that are being talked about in the literature. Now, is this important? It's happening, or this type, people are describing that way. So to understand this importance, the studies so far have mentioned that the proteins that are involved in this MCSNG, or a molecular membrane curvature sensing and generation, and if the malfunction of those several of those proteins may lead to diseases. For example, this ENTH domain of a protein called Epsin R, ENTH is a one that generates curvature via hydrophobic insertion. So it can cause schizophrenia. Then there are other COP complex of another protein, SAR1, quad lipid absorption disorder, and there are several others. Bird domains, this is also a particular region which can cause, generate or sense curvature, and the malfunction of such proteins cause several diseases. So this has been established that the malfunction of those proteins involved in MC and ASG can cause diseases. But it's not clearly established whether this malfunctioning part of the domains that are involved in MC and ASG can lead to such the scenario. So that part is not clear yet, but nevertheless we'll go ahead and study the membrane curvature sensing and generation aspects. So from now I'll talk about a biophysical study. We'll leave about how we try to understand this. So this biophysical study is done on a model bilayer or lipid bilayer in the laboratory. How are they made? They are made using dry lipid powders, which can be obtained, available in a you can commercially. So you can bring them, follow certain protocol, and then you can make these giant unilamellar vesicles. They are nothing but closed sac. You can think of it as a football filled with like surface and water inside and outside. Water meaning water and some other say salty solution or something like that. Okay, and so these are the GUVs. They are called giant because they are in the large size, large meaning in micron size rather, and unilamellar meaning you only have one particular bilayer made of, just like plasma membrane, there is only one bilayer. Now in this picture which we have obtained in the laboratory, you can see the cross section of an sectional view of an axisymmetric vesicle with two different types of lipid domains. The blue one or the green one in the right picture are mostly enriched with cholesterol and saturated lipid. I'll not get into the details of what the saturated lipid is, but you can ask me later if you want to know. And the other part is the continuous disordered lipid, the unsaturated lipids. And what happens is if you bring them together with the right proportion, and when you come to a proper temperature, at around room temperature, they segregate into these two regions. And these green are mostly cholesterol enriched domain with saturated lipid, and the red are mostly cholesterol depleted unsaturated lipid domain. Why are they there? These micro domains, or this green or blue like domains here, they're a little larger in the right side figure. These micro domains are the ones where several proteins bind to. They have a preferential binding to these microdomains, and that lead to various other cell level functioning, like signaling out by proteins and etc. So that's why these ordered disordered phases is important, which cells do maintain in a much more dynamic environment. For our study, it's not much relevant, but I thought I would mention their importance in this case. And next, we will go to an experimental situation where this curvature sensing and generation aspects can be studied. Although we have this vesicle I have mentioned, these are micron size or 10 to 100 micron diameter
sacs with made of lipid bilayer, and you arrest them in a micropipette. It's like a micro scale version of glass capillary, and induce some lateral tension on this surface so that membrane is taut, and then attach a bead or some to the other side of the GUV and pull on the away from the GUV. And if the attachment is strong enough, what will happen from this vesicle, you will get a narrow tube like structure, single. And typically, depending on, of course, the how taut the membrane is, the this narrow tube, which we call a tether, can be 10 to 100 nanometer in diameter, and the GUV size is 10 to 100 microns. It's about a factor of 1000, if not factor of 1200, in the order of 100 definitely. So if we want to do some theoretical analysis of such an experimental scenario, we can treat the membrane, GUV membrane part, as flat membrane, and the tube is connected to it with a constant radius. And it's like idealization is a tube pulled from a flat surface. So now, to understand or to develop a model for to understand how this happens in a continuum framework, if we want to, that's what I am. We have been doing. What we need to know is we need to understand how the what is the mechanical behavior of this GUV membrane and the tube membrane, how proteins behave on the surface of this GUV or the lipid bilayer, and how, and we know from our the description that proteins like compatible curvature, or sometimes they may dislike, and proteins come and bind to the membrane, etc., etc. So for those, we need a model also. That's like one, three aspects: elasticity model for the bilayer, some protein behavior of proteins to be modeled on the how they behave on the membrane surface, and what is the curvature mediated interaction between protein and the lipid bilayer. So these are the three elements that we need to know. So I'll start with elasticity model for lipid bilayer briefly. So physicists approach this problem in a different way, but coming from a mechanical engineering background, I will approach it in a thin shell theory, which many of you, especially in the this IEEE society, would know. So you can, so it's like a digress, not really directly related to the problem I'm describing, but it will help you understand or get a different perspective. So what we have here is a thin shell, which is like your thin sheet. You take it and you wrap it around as a cylinder or any other shape that you have. And to define the deformation, when we can think of the every point on the thin shell has displacement in three orthogonal directions. And if we look at more closely and zoom in here, what we will see that thin shell has thickness, however small it may be, it has a mid surface at with radius r, and a generic point will be just some distance away from the middle surface. And the generic displacement of the generic point can be described by these three quantities, U1, U2, and U3. So U1 is the displacement along the axial direction for this case, but you don't need to worry about that. It is one of the directions on the plane of the or the surface of the membrane or the mid surface. So U1 can be related to the displacements at this particular point at the mid surface, or a point on the mid surface, or you can call it the corresponding point on the mid surface. And by a function, it can be complicated, theta1, or the z multiplied by z, or the proportional to z. And U2, similarly, this is the tangential displacement, can be treated as the tangential displacement of the mid surface point, and another function which is proportional to z. And U3 for thin shell is treated as W, and rho, the radius of curvature for this generic point here, is, so this would be your rho. So that is R plus Z. Okay. And what is theta1 and theta2? That depend on the shell theory that you choose. There are several shell theories. You have Kirkov-Lapp shell theory, you have Donnell nonlinear shell theory, plug equilibrium shell theory, there's several. And they differ on how you choose theta1 and theta2. But what happens in this thin shell is, the conventional ones, it cannot account for large deformation and it cannot account for the in-plane fluidity. So, and there are other, nuisances also. There's a mismatch, or they cannot sometimes predict the static buckling pressure correctly, etc., which you will not discuss, but there have been talked about in this particular paper. And so we will need a resort to a more generic shell theory and specialize to the bilayer. So this particular shell theory comes from the mid-surface directly. So we have a mid-surface shown by the shaded region. And that mid-surface is described by, in an undeformed or reference configuration by two surface parameters, U1 and U2. And then any position can be treated as a vector in the three-dimensional space R. Okay? So reference configuration is R. When it deforms due to load or whatever, then due to this deformation, it will go to a current configuration or deformed configuration, which is denoted by small r. And then surface coordinates, as I was saying, U1 and U2, we denote as U alpha, U1 to 2. And then you have the tangent vectors. They are simply the derivatives of the position vector of that point with respect to your surface coordinates. So similarly, so we have two surfaces, one at the reference and one at the current. So both these surfaces will have tangent vectors as defined this. And then in the, you can define certain quantities. You don't need to pay much details, but you can define them as fundamental form and the normal vector using those tangent vectors. Surface normal vector as n, small n in the current configuration and capital N in the deformed configuration. And what does Coursera shell theory do, different from others, is it defines a director vector. So director vector is actually a vector which is somewhat along the direction of the thickness. Okay. So if, and for the lipid molecules, it's quite appropriate. The director vectors are like directed along the molecule. So we have long molecules, we have seen them. So directors are directed along those molecules. Okay. And in the theory, it is assumed that in the reference configuration, director may match with the normal vector, but when it deforms, it need not be the case. But in a general Coursera shell theory, but it can be the normal vector at the current configuration also, which we will see. So as I said, director vector will represent the orientation of material fibers in a direction which is not the surface direction, so independent of the surface direction, the third direction. Now when we specialize to lipid bilayer, there are a few things that we need to know. That this is from the experimental observation, if you look at the lipid bilayer and try to compress them in a laterally, like in a two-dimensional manner, then the lipid bilayer is incompressible, or it's called locally inextensible. And that is replicated by this fact that square root of A is equal to, the deformed and current configuration are same. And the square root of A is this quantity obtained from the fundamental form. You define a matrix or a tensor using the tangent vectors and take the determinant of it. And that is used to define a small differential area element. Okay. So that's one. And the molecules are aligned normal to the surface. So then small d, the director at the current configuration, will be treated as n. So incompressibility is taken into account. Now the fluidity part. Okay. So fluidity part has been worked out by Jenkins and Steichman and several others. And they were the area preserving. So deformation is something in the continuum literature. So if you sort of look at the reference configuration, deform it such a way that it doesn't change its area. So those are called unimodular deformation, and they are related to certain tensors of which have determinant unity. Okay? So if you do that, then the free energy, if you forget the fluid part for now, the free energy will be a function of the director vector, the normal vector, and the gradient of the director, because those are all associated with the cost. Like if you want to change the director vector from point to point, then that will lead to deforming the molecule or aligning the molecule in a certain way. So that will have some cost. So that will all go to the free energy or the strain energy. Now, for the lipid bilayer, since d is n, so gradient of d becomes gradient of n. That's what we have here. Now, when we put any unimodular deformation, that will be denoted by Q, then N goes to Qn, and the gradient of N goes to this transformation, Qn, Q transpose. And Q now is a orthogonal tensor. If you like matrices, you can call it orthogonal matrices when the coordinate system is chosen. Now, once you have put all these, that W cannot change when you put this orthogonal transformation as denoted by unimodular transformation, then the free energy or the strain energy for the elastic bilayer must be dependent on the invariance of gradient of N. Okay? Now, interpretation of gradient of N is the curvature tensor of the surface. Why? If you have a normal vector and if you think of a flat surface, the normal doesn't change. So, it doesn't have any curvature. But if the normal changes in a certain way, slow or very fast, then we know the surface is less curved or highly curved. So that's why gradient of N is related to the curvature tensor. And then if we have a curvature tensor, the trace of it or the sum of the diagonal terms will give you mean curvature, and the product of the diagonal terms will give you Gaussian curvature. Okay, so those are the two scalar invariants. So we can now comfortably say, since free energy must be dependent on invariance of N, it must be a function of H and K. It's the scalar invariance of a gradient of N. Okay. Now we'll again simplify to our axisymmetric scenario for the tube pulled from a vesicle. Then for the time being, forget that we have a connected to a flat membrane, but it's just some shape, axisymmetric shape, and it is changing. So then we have two principal curvatures, C1 and C2. So the mean curvature will be average of the two. You can call the sum of the two also, doesn't matter. This factor of two can be taken care of or you can ignore it. But the essence is the invariant is C1 plus C2. And then you have the Gaussian curvature as C1 into C2. And then the simplest free energy density that we can have will be kappa, that's a constant, into H minus H naught squared. Okay, I will come to H naught in a bit, but and then kappa G into K. Okay, why kappa H minus H naught square? Are you able to see me on a video?
I'm able to.
Okay, so we have this flat paper. Now you can think of this as a flat membrane. Now if I want to bend it this way or bend it upward, pretty much if I want to bend by the same amount, I'll be spending the same amount of energy. So that's why it should be quadratic in H. So it's kappa H square. But as we are telling, that proteins can generate curvature. Sometimes lipid also make the bilayer deformed. So instead of its preferred scenario being flat, because of the presence of proteins or certain lipids, what's kind of the membrane may want to be in a curved situation. So that is the H naught, which is called spontaneous curvature or the intrinsic curvature of the bilayer. So, and then the energy will come when you try to deform it from this preferred configuration this way or the other way. Okay. So that's why we have this H minus H naught square. Okay. Okay, now we'll go to the thermodynamic models for proteins. So as I mentioned, that proteins, they bind to the GUV, the other proteins that were involved in MS and AST, molecular membrane curvature sensing and generation. They migrate, once you have the GUV and pull the tube, depending on the curvature preference, proteins can either migrate from the vesicle, the GUV membrane, to the tube if they prefer high curvature region, or if they don't prefer high curvature region, they can migrate either from the tube and go crowd around the GUV. But since the membrane is fluid-like, proteins can do that quite fast. Okay? So we can think of them as a protein, as a fluid on the surface. Surface meaning they are restricted to the surface of the GUV or surface of the membrane. So you can think of proteins as a gas on the surface. Now, we can, the ideal gas models won't work. We need to go for non-ideal gas models. So we have two simplest models, or the when you think about non-ideal gas models, the first one that comes to our mind is the van der Waals gas model. And the van der Waals gas model will have a free energy of this form. Eta is the area density of the proteins, or the area coverage. Okay, so defined this way, the number of proteins per unit area into area of the proteins. That's how the eta is defined. And then since you have two entities, eta one will be the protein coverage fraction on the vesicle, and one will be protein area coverage fraction on the tube. And this the area coverage eta on the tube or on the GUV won't change much, because the GUV area is infinitely large compared to the area of the tube, right? Because of this shear size. And then you can add an attraction parameter for the van der Waals gas, and these are just some Lagrange multipliers based on it's just some spinning or the to get the free energy Legendre operations. Now then we have the Bragg-Williams model, which is similar to van der Waals. The genesis of Bragg-Williams model, you can come think of it as, instead of just the area exclusion that we have observed in the van der Waals gas model, the Bragg-Williams model will have, like, you have a lattice of the n sites and it's occupied by n particles. These particles are now proteins. Now when n is significantly smaller compared to the lattice sites, but both go to infinity, then you get this free energy for the Bragg-Williams gas model. And you can also have some interaction between the molecules, that they may prefer to go towards their own type of molecules. Okay. So the we have taken care of the elasticity of the bilayer. We have taken care of the protein as a gas model, and now we can combine them all and write down the free energy for the experimental scenario. So that is the total free energy will be this quantity called epsilon integrated over the surface of the tube and the GUV. But the GUV part, we can think of it as constant, this being large, so we'll just think of it as the near the tube only. And then epsilon is incorporating the elasticity of the membrane, the energy or the mixing energy of the proteins as a gas, some constant, that incompressibility constant is here. And then since we're focusing on axisymmetric scenario, this is a condition put to ensure that the deformation is axisymmetric. And since you're pulling, then that also leads to some external work done. So that also means that F is the pulling force, and it's getting pulled by a certain distance. Okay. So that's how the total energy goes into picture. And this part, this spontaneous curvature or isotropic curvature that spontaneous curvature that I was mentioning, if more proteins bind, they may be able to make the membrane of the bilayer deform more and go to a certain preferred curvature. And that preferred curvature is denoted as C naught eta, and it increases linearly with a protein, more concentration of proteins. Of course, this is a debatable model, but that's the first one we can get started with. Okay. And then this one, as I told you, this gamma is denoting the proteins as gas on the membrane. So we have all the ingredients put in. Now we'll see what happens to the proteins when you give them the tube, okay, the preferred curvature. So here is the situation. You can think of this as the curvature of the tube. So I'll write it as 1 over radius of the tube in the x-axis. And this one, please forgive me, because I'm just pulling it out from my previous paper, and PDF I couldn't change it. So theta over theta basically will become eta over eta vesicle. That is the ratio of the protein concentration on the tube to the protein concentration on the vesicle. Okay, and vesicle is being large, you can treat it as a reservoir, and it's more or less constant. So this quantity will define as sorting. Okay. So sorting is the one which tells you whether the proteins are moving to the tube or not. Okay, and we begin with a uniform vesicle protein concentration on the vesicle membrane. As you can see, with very small sort of curvature, that is when the tube radius is large. This is radius. Okay, I'm sorry. This is radius. Okay, so when the tube radius is very small or very high curvature, then the proteins try to move to the tube much more. So the ratio is 8 or of the order of 10. Okay, in both the models. Okay, and the right side part I'll talk in a bit later. So you can see that the proteins do prefer the high curvature region, and that is because this term that we have protein C naught eta, that more proteins bind, they generate more curvature, and so other proteins may want to move towards that region. So it's like this first term is kind of denoting the curvature generation aspect, and more proteins being sorting ratio being larger than one is going into the sensing aspect. Now this these have been verified with experiments, as I'm not showing them here, but they have been fitted with experiments and got very quite amazing results. The one I'm talking about here is for a protein called KVAP, the potassium channel, and so there the same van der Waals model for the protein. And the spontaneous curvature model was not talked about. This is the different, the curvature interaction model was put in, and they do match with the experiments reasonably well. Okay. And also we have checked with not just vesicles pulled with, GVs with a tube pulled. We have checked results with, so you give them small liposomes, like spherical vesicles with a nanometer scale size. That's also highly curved. Whether the proteins are binding more to such vesicles or not. So that also have been observed experimentally here, and we have verified that. But one question that that I found is this: both van der Waals and Bradley Lumps models are crude in a sense. They are treating the proteins as hard particles or hard circular disks, and I also mentioned they are circular. But are all the proteins circular, and are they all can they all be treated as hard? This part we can be debated. So we'll go to more motivation towards whether these van der Waals and Bradley Lumps type of models are good or not in the context of some proteins that have been studied. So here is an example of the structure of a rat endophilin N-bar protein. So there are two N-bar domains. This one is one N-bar, and then the blue one is another N-bar. So they form a dimer, and they bind to the membrane. How do they do? There's one. This all the Ks are sort of positively charged residues. They bind to lipid head, which are negatively charged. So in fact, in the experiment to make it happen, we have to choose some lipids which have negative head group or negatively charged head group, and then the other part is your this alpha helix. Oh, I'm sorry, this is happening on and off. This is some region, hydrophobic region, that inserts into the membrane, and when it inserts, we have studied in this paper that they deform the membrane, so this they generate. So this part, this positively charged one, brings the protein close to the membrane, and then once this alpha helix inserts into the membrane, it generates curvature. So we can keep part this part as generation. And on top of that, so this is a cross-sectional view, like a banana if you think of. But if you look at the projected shape of the banana, or this crescent shaped protein on the membrane, it's not really circle. It's far away from the circle, and you can at the most you can do best by approximating as an ellipse. So protein shape is not isotropic. By isotropic I mean circular, but rather it's anisotropic, and the simplest of such anisotropic shape we can take is ellipse. So if we want to study such proteins, we must have incorporated the anisotropic shape, or an elliptical shape at least. And here is some more approximation of the curvature of the proteins. You can see the radius of curvature is about 85 angstrom, which is kind of 9 nanometers or so. So it's inverse of that. So 0.1 or so is the curvature. And the other side depth of this given as 30 angstrom or so. So that's for the M dot. Different domains may have different curvature. And that would be the intrinsic curvature of the protein. If you think of it as a rigid molecule, this need not be the exact curvature of the membrane. Now, so we want to incorporate this, we want to modify this gamma. We know that this, if you want to look at this non-circular shape, the Van der Waals model won't be good enough, or Drag Williams model won't be good enough. So we go with this convex particle scenario. So convex particle is kind of elliptical particle, you can think of one such case. And now we can think of these particles have some sort of short range interaction potential. It could be electrostatic or many more. And because of those effects, the potential depends on the shortest distance between this envelope, okay, of the molecule. And this envelope is the hard particle. There won't be any penetration beyond this envelope, but the actual protein may have regions little bit outside the envelope as well, just like it happens in the soft particle like Lennard-Jones type particle. Okay, so once you have that incorporated, then there will be an interaction between the these particles, which can be modeled by an interaction potential or pairwise interaction potential. And also, because of this presence of this particle here, the distribution of other particles around it will be dictated by the shape as well as the interaction bottom of them. So that quantity is sort of defined by or encountered with the radial distribution function. Like, it's once a particle is present, how the other particles are distributed, that's this G, and then U is the interaction potential. And once you have those two, you can write the equation of state as P as a function of rho and temperature using this expression. Okay, and they have in several integrals, and it's a different matter that G is quite unknown in most cases, as well as not all potentials can be put in and then integrated to get a nice analytical form of the equation of state. But nevertheless, we can do something about it. So what we do is I am sorry, these pictures are not shown here, but it's kind of the same. The convex particles were there, and two other scenarios where we're thinking. One was this, the convex particles with a potential depending on the distance between the envelopes. Similarly, these convex particles, when it becomes circles, and again the potential depends on the distance between the surfaces, and then you have circular particles, and the potential depends on the center to center distance, that is the Lennard-Jones type of particle. So all these cases, the potential now can be incorporated by a Lennard-Jones type expression, which is called Kihara-Kode potential, which is depending on the distance between the minimum distance between the surfaces. Okay, so that's what we will be using. So once we put that in and try to evaluate that integral, it's not easy. You have to make a lot of approximations. That is, you have to decompose the potential into its attractive part, into its repulsive part, etc. And once you do all those, which I'm not going into the details, you get the equation of state, the pressure versus the density or the number density, as this long expression. This first part has AA, which is the attraction parameter, that is dependent on the attractive part of the potential. The AR is the repulsion parameter, which depends on the repulsive part of the potential. And then you have alpha, which is the shape parameter. The shape parameter means how far away you are from a circular shape. If it is circle, it is 1. If it is a non-circular oblate or a convex shape, it's always larger than 1. So more the value, far away it is from the circle. And then B is the size parameter, what is the effective size of the molecule. It's not exactly the hardcore, the envelope size. It rather depends on the interaction potential also. The interaction potential tells you what is the effective size of the particles can be. So therefore, these parameters will depend on the core size and another we call temperature, but more than the temperature I call it as the strength of the potential, that epsilon that we have used in this expression. Okay, and then once we have the equation of state in terms of pressure, we can always calculate the free energy by other thermodynamic relations, which I am not showing here. Now we are presenting here the pressure versus density, and what we see is they do, I mean, differ significantly from the van der Waals gas model that we have chosen earlier. Now in the right side picture, we are comparing the equation of state, which is the solid line from our theory, and compared with the molecular dynamics simulation for a similar kind of potential and similar kind of particle shape and etc. for different temperature. The temperature meaning is the inverse of the interaction potential. Okay, it's like scaled temperature is scaled by the interaction potential strength. So higher the temperature is lower the interaction potential strength. So in all those cases, we can see the pressure versus the density is matching quite well. And another thing I would like to mention here is that we have used the Kihara potential, or the Lennard-Jones type potential, but if you have more specific information, and then if you can calculate a more detailed, in a more detailed way, the actual potential between the protein-protein interaction, that can be incorporated into this framework. Now, further in the comparison, we do see the comparison for different scenarios between the pressure and density, and X is internal energy calculated from the equation of state versus density, and we see that higher the temperature, the better is the agreement between the theory and simulation. So we have to, in the temperature wise, we have to be in a reasonably high regime. Okay. So now we have a more, rather I say more comprehensive version of the model for the protein. The dielectricity model does not change. Now we have to go to the, attack the other one, where the spontaneous curvature was treated as C naught into eta, very linear expression for depending on the protein concentration or protein area fraction. So how do we account for that? So this is where we'll be attacking this term now. And the way we do is, imagine now we have a membrane surface and the protein is sitting on it. Okay, then the protein may have different curvature in different directions. So this is the protein molecule. It can have curvature in one curvature in that direction and one curvature in this direction. Similarly, the membrane that is sitting in may have different sort of curvature along that different direction. So this black one is the membrane, and one and two are the principal curvature directions, and green lines here are the protein. This is the protein shape, and 1M and 2M are the protein principal curvature. Now if we draw a line arbitrarily, as shown here, we draw an arbitrary line, both the curvatures of the protein and membrane along the line will be different. You can calculate those using this angle psi and the principal curvatures of the protein and principal curvatures of the membrane. You can calculate those. I am not showing that expression here. So they're different. Now what this model is telling, that because of there is a mismatch in the curvature, protein is trying to deform the membrane to conform to its curvature. So that means it has to have a cost associated to it because of the curvature mismatch. Okay. So that's the curvature mismatch model. So then this is the CM is the membrane curvature along that arbitrary line, and CM is the protein curvature along that arbitrary line, and C is the membrane curvature along the arbitrary line, and the energy penalty or due to curvature mismatch for binding one protein is given by this expression. Once you do that, And this protein, the curvature mismatch is in every direction. So if you change angle theta from 0 to 2 pi, you get the overall full curvature mismatch energy. And that once integrated gives this expression. And that's why one protein. Now there will be many, many proteins sitting on the membrane in an arbitrary orientation. Not in this particular case, what I'm showing is the mismatch, orientation mismatch between the principal directions of membrane curvature and protein curvature is omega. Okay. But it can be different for different proteins. And once you incorporate that, then the integrator of all possible omegas, then you get this complex expression for the curvature mismatch energy, which is far, far more complicated than the expression that was taken earlier. And QC is this, and I0 is some kind of Bessel function, it's a modified Bessel function of first kind. So once you put that in that module, so we have this, let me go back, we have the energy for the curvature mismatch, so that is, that will become our interaction, curvature mediated interaction, or the interaction between protein binding and the membrane curvature. Okay, so this, we have elasticity model, and we have more elaborate model for the protein sitting on the membrane or bound to the membrane. Once you put all those, then we get this sorting again is defined as eta over eta vesicle, that is the ratio of the tube protein concentration to vesicle protein concentration, and it's this again somewhat more long expression, but don't worry about it. That what the essential part of this is, it depends on some parameters, and the left hand side only depends on the protein as a gas, meaning the convex fluid parameters, and the right hand side is mainly depend on the curvature mismatch. So that will depend on the protein's intrinsic curvatures denoted by H. Okay, and so that's all, and it depends on certain parameters. So it's the attraction parameter that we have lambda 1, which is a ratio of the AA that we defined before, B as the size parameter, the scaled quantity. Similarly, we have this B as the size parameter, and then lambda 2 is the repulsion parameter, earlier repulsive parameter scaled by B, and then we have a parameter alpha, that's the shape parameter that we have mentioned. Okay, and so key parameters, as I mentioned, the left hand side was mainly because of the proteins as a convex fluid, so it has its core size, whatever all we needed, the shape of the protein, the size of the core, shape of the protein, and its interaction, okay, strength of the interaction potential, and the, from these three quantities we have a derived parameter lambda 1 and lambda 2, those are attraction and repulsion parameters. And similarly for the curvature ones, we have a scaled mean curvature of the protein, so that is the isotropic component of the protein curvature, and beta 0 is the scaled deviatory curvature, and that is what is the difference, the difference between the principal curvatures. Once you have a difference, then the protein curvature is also anisotropic, meaning it can induce different curvature in different directions. That is, if I go along this way, the protein can induce certain curvature. If I go along this way, the protein may induce a different curvature. So that's beta being non-zero. Okay. Now, we try to understand.
So with the shape anisotropy, we do see sorting decreases, and with the curvature anisotropy, if we go down below, then the sorting quantity S as a function of curvature, the maximum one, it goes from 6 to 10 or more, so which means the anisotropic curvature enhances this sorting, whereas the anisotropic shape sort of decreases the effect of sorting. But the soft convex molecule, that is the elliptical molecules with interatomic or the intermolecular potential, that leads to higher sorting effect compared to hard disk model of van der Waals or Bragg-Williams or any other similar hard disk model, but non-circular. So what does that mean? Is the both anisotropy in shape and curvature are important. And we have some Monte Carlo simulations on liposomes, which was done with Professor Sunil Kumar and his student Sachin Krishnan. And there you see that if we increase the interaction strength denoted by mu, a lipid vesicle, which was more or less spherical, becomes a tubular. And through this Monte Carlo simulation, we have also shown that they're able to generate, separate the generation and sensing regimes. One is when the pressure is low, the membranes are more floppy, then the protein may be able to deform the membrane more. So in that scenario, generation happens. But when the pressure is high compared to the binding strength, then the sensing is the only option the proteins have that you can see in this cartoon. So to summarize, we have presented a more comprehensive model for the interaction between protein and the membrane. And we have done, in collaboration, we have done some experiments, and some experiments were obtained from literature. We are also planning to verify our model with several experiments in the future. So these are some ongoing work. And I would like to acknowledge the following people, Paritosh Mahata and Pranav are the students I had at IIT Kanpur. Sachin was a student at IIT Madras, now is a postdoc in Germany. And Sunil Kumar, Sarvanand Matheswaran from, respectively from IIT Madras, or his IIT Palakkad and IIT Kanpur. And then Sasas Bettina and Gwen Bozic from University of Ljubljana. And Tobias Baumgart, who got introduced me to all these problems from University of Pennsylvania. And these are final supports. So I'm really sorry for the disruption, and that's the end. Now, you can ask questions.
Thanks, Shravan. There are a few questions.
Yes.
So Prasenjit Ghosh has asked quite a few questions. So I'll just go in that order.
Okay.
So if a membrane can have fluid-like behavior, can it also have structural integrity like an elastic body?
Yes, it does. In fact, that's what makes these membranes special. I can give you one example where the soap film that you see in day-to-day life, they're also fluid membrane. Fluid membrane, in a sense, if you look at the surface of the soap film and put some small tiny dye particle, it will move along the surface of the soap film quite rapidly. So that means the it has a liquid or fluid nature. Okay, but the soap film has one aspect that doesn't have one aspect that these membranes have. The soap films do not resist bending, but these lipid bilayer membranes, they do resist bending. And the reason is, let's say you have two lipid molecules, and if you want to bend and make lipid molecules at a flat surface, flat bilayer, and if you want to, let me put my video on. Yeah. So, am I visible, Revati?
No, but it's okay.
If you have a flat bilayer, then the lipid molecules are all straight up, right? Now, when you try to bend it up or down, then the lipid heads come. If you bend, try to bend up, the lipid heads will come closer to each other, whereas the tails will try to go away. Or the lipid heads from the top side will come close to each other, and the lipid heads from the bottom side will try to go far away. So that leads to some sort of cost. You have to apply some force to make it happen. And that's why they have the elasticity when you try to deform them out of plane. But in plane, if you want to shear them, they will just shear like a liquid.
Okay. Then can we model the proteins bound or unbound to the membrane as small solid particles instead of gas particles on the membrane surface?
Okay. See, the proteins are, in fact, if you think about gas particles, they are the particles solid, but they're just rigid particles. But what it means, the gas, is how they sort of see each other in a way. So this solid particle, and in fact, your intuition is correct. The proteins are solid particles bound on the membrane, and they move in a random direction, like a Brownian type of motion. Okay. Now, if you have many of such solid particles on the membrane bound and they're moving in a random way, you can treat them collectively as a gas. Okay. Okay. And if you say solid, then the proteins are not moving, then nothing is happening. So then the bilayer has to be a solid in that.
Okay. Can the membrane material be considered as elastic at all? If so, is it linear elastic, nonlinear elastic, or viscoelastic?
In fact, it can be considered all of them, depending on the scenario. But in this particular case, we are modeling them as a curvature squared. So in a sense, it is becoming a nonlinear elastic model, but it's a geometric nonlinearity, not a material nonlinearity. But in some special cases, you can model linear elastic. But other cell membranes, the actual cell membrane sometimes has various other things. And in a smaller time scale, you can treat them as viscoelastic. But what we are doing here is mostly equilibrium solutions. So even if you put viscoelastic, viscous nature, it won't matter much in that case.
Okay. As the capability for large deformation was sought for a membrane model, what is the amount of deformation a membrane can typically undergo?
Huge. Okay. Revati, I have also joined.
Shovan, I think you can, yeah.
Join from the computer.
That's fine,
again.
That's fine. Right. So can you answer that question, Shovan? Shovan, you're muted.
Yeah. What was the question again? I got distracted in this. Please.
As the capability for large deformation was sought for a membrane model, what is the amount of deformation a membrane can typically undergo?
Yeah. So in this particular scenario, we could let the membranes deform significantly. I mean, really, really large deformation. And if I think of a spherical shape to start with, and if you allow the volume to change, then it can become a almost dumbbell shaped. And in fact, let me share the screen once more with that just give me a second. If I can you see this PPT slide?
Yes.
I will not make it full screen anymore. So you see this shape on the top left panel, and what you see is quite far away from the spherical shape, right? And such shapes can be obtained when you start from sphere as your initial configuration. So that much deformation is possible, and it's okay because it's mainly from the geometric nonlinearity part.
Okay. And the other thing is, how can we justify a continuum assumption for membrane?
Okay, as far as the continuum hypothesis goes, like if your ensemble, like if you are thinking of a solid, linear elastic solid, right, let's say, and if a particular body has molecules of the order of few tens, like 10, 50, then you can model it as a continuum. And in this scenario, we have thousands of lipid molecules. The lipid head-group area is a few nanometers squared, and the total surface area of the bilayer membrane in a cell or in this vesicle or in the membrane tube you can think of is at least few micrometers squared to tens of micrometers squared. So then you have thousands of lipid molecules, and they will behave as a continuum. Similarly, the other question you can probably pose here, can we treat proteins as gas? Because then there may not be many. But again, in an experiment of these scales, you will have many, many proteins. It's not just one or two proteins. And again, you can treat them as continuum. So order of presence of such molecules will be at least a few tens to make have the continuum model work.
Is it possible to model the mechanics of protein membrane interactions without considering the thermodynamics of it? What are the limitations?
On an individual protein level, you can do it. In fact, you can think of protein as a rigid entity or an elastic entity, somewhat stiffer than the membrane, and it has some sort of curvature based interaction. And then you see how the proteins deform the membrane. So, which we have done. Using finite element simulation. I was talking about Mahata and Das paper, which was published in Fabs Letters, that are there in the slides. And there we have seen, we have introduced protein as a rigid entity,
when it inserts the helix, that's a rigid intracellular membrane. And in this case, when you look at the zoom in more to the lipid bilayer, incorporate its thickness and all in such a scale single protein with the lipid, then you cannot think of lipid as a thin shell anymore. It has some thickness, because the protein membrane thickness is 2 to 3 nanometers, and the protein is also put the part that enters into the membrane, part of the protein that enters into the membrane is again a few nanometer, half a nanometer sometimes, or half the membrane thickness. So in that case, you cannot ignore the membrane thickness. So in such a scenario, it is possible to model the lipid bilayer as transversely isotropic material, but it has a very low in-plane shear stiffness to go closer to the fluidity. It's possible, but then you can do only individual proteins. But if you have many, many, then such analysis won't be really feasible.
Can MD simulate the entire surface of a membrane? Is simulating the entirety even required to study protein membrane interactions?
MD simulations, it can to a limited extent. That was what the Monte Carlo simulation part we had done at some point. But Monte Carlo is not MD, it's based on the continuum model to go away from the non-axisymmetric shape to see whether the proteins can generate shapes that are not axisymmetric. So when we, the our analysis was done based on axisymmetry, that's a very special scenario, but proteins may not do that in a reality. So to get to the non-axisymmetry, we have done Monte Carlo, again from the continuum model. And that itself was quite expensive computationally. Other than that, for the membrane, like tens of nanometer diameter tube pulled from the GUV and assembly, I mean, simulating that, we have tried it. It did not quite work yet. But if you want to do MD simulation for proteins as a bead model or some other model and bring in lipid molecules, then again you can do for one or two, few proteins, not many. So get a statistics, I mean, of curvature sensing generation type won't be as simple. But in the continuum theory, you get a overall picture quite quickly.
Chandra has a question. Is there any relation between the two
films? I really don't know. This is a good question. Typically, what I know though is the membranes that proteins that are involved in curvature sensing and generation do not really form a pore. If you mean by pore, if you mean the channel, so in most cases they don't. The ones that form channels are integral membrane proteins, and most of them do not induce any curvature. The KVAP, the potassium channel we mentioned, has some aspects of it, though. Other than that, I don't know how to answer your question.
And Sachin also has a question. In the anisotropic model, are the proteins also allowed to change their orientation locally? And how can we understand the effect of temperature parameter? How can one control in the experiments?
Yeah. So in the anisotropic curvature model, the proteins are allowed to change their orientation locally. Okay. In fact, it is sort of random, and depending on the compatibility of the membrane and the protein curvatures, they may orient in a particular way. And the temperature is mainly due to the interaction between the proteins. Okay. For example, if we look at the hard particle model, then you have the hard particle potential for the proteins, then temperature is very high, really, really large. And when you allow penetration and large attraction between the proteins, and in such a scenario, what will happen is the temperature would be less.
And Gajendran Parthasarathy has asked if there are some applications for this kind of
Okay. One thing is, idea is this particular modeling we have done is mainly to understand the basics or the fundamentals, how the complex shapes and etc. are there in the cell. But in the application wise, one was definitely, it's a quite long way to go. But as I mentioned before, that membrane curvature sensing proteins, if they malfunction, they can cause several diseases. Now, if we understand this sensing and generation part well, and in the experiment, if we can control the curvature sensing and generating domains of the proteins, I mean, by doing some engineering and controlling the structure of the proteins, which can be done in the laboratory now, the way you express proteins, you can sort of remove certain portion, and that portion can be the region where the curvature generation motif or the core part is there. So once you sort of modify such structures and then try to see how it is happening to the membrane curvature and sensing and generation, and then correlate to the disease, that will have a that's a good application I can think of. Other thing we are sort of getting into is how these proteins and some similar macromolecules interact with the membrane and its curvature and lead to their antimicrobial and anti-cancer type of activities. Can we study this interaction and go towards developing such antimicrobial, anti-cancer, etc. drug? Okay, so this is what we are sort of getting into. And the reason we are saying that this will have application is most of these molecules that work in a drug or this cell functionality, most of the time their first interaction is with the membrane of the cell or membrane of the internal components. So that interaction is quite important. And applicable as well.
Thanks, Shovan. There are many other questions as well. So in the interest of time, maybe we can share the questions with you later, and you guys can, you can clarify the doubts with the audience.
Yeah. So should I clarify those through email or?
We will definitely share the questions with you.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you all for attending. We will again meet in 2 weeks' time. The next talk is by Professor Mary Frecker of Penn State University. The talk again will be on September 9th. At 6 p.m. The title of the talk is Optimization of Smart and Adaptive Structures. Thank you all for attending.
Okay. Thank you all, and I'm really sorry for the disturbance towards the end.
No problem. Thank you, Shovan.
Thank you
for the very detailed talk.
Bye-bye.